Today we're going to talk about our final assignment, the usability test. In this assignment, you will choose a poorly designed small-scale website, analyze its flaws, design to test the website's flaws by watching a user attempt to perform a set of targeted tasks, and then report back to your client on your findings, suggesting changes based on what you've seen. And when I say client, I do mean that you're going to pretend that you are working for a company, i.e. the client, and that you're convincing your client to redesign or improve the flaws of the company's website. During a traditional semester, the fall or spring semester, technical writing students usually create 3 separate documents for this unit, but I'm only asking you to complete 2. For this summer semester. So 4.1 assignment will be the usability test proposal, and 4.2 assignment will be a report where you will give a evaluation on your findings. You've already done a basic usability test this semester by asking an expert to review your instruction set, the subject matter expert that reviewed your instruction set, and some of you watched the subject matter expert perform the process. So that basically is a usability test. And also, every time you ask someone to peer review your paper, you're also running a basic usability test in that you're asking a different kind of user to give you insight about something that you've created. Usability tests let designers gain an understanding and insight on the things they've designed. Also, think about the user persona that you created for the instruction set. Your user persona was created with the objective to give you an understanding of what users needed in the instruction set. So I noticed that some of you had fun in creating this fictional persona, which is great, and it was funny to read some of the details and characteristics that you associated to user personas. But I started to wonder and kind of worry if you use the user persona in the way that it was meant to be used. So a user persona is supposed to represent the group of users that would use your instruction set and give you a deeper understanding of what their needs are. If you did not use the user persona in this way, then you probably designed the instruction set based on your needs or based on the needs of a population that you're familiar with. And a user persona, however, is supposed to give you better insight as to the needs of other types of users and other kinds of populations that you might overlook. So keep that in mind as you're creating the user persona for this assignment. So a big component in this unit, besides writing the 2 papers, is actually running a usability test. And a side note here, 4.1, which is the first paper, is due on July 24th, so Sunday, by 11:59, and 4.2 is due on the last day of class, which is August 4th, and that one will be due by noon. So by 12 noon, you should submit 4.2 on Friday, August 4th. Keep that in mind because most of the major assignments, actually all of the major assignments, have been due by 11:59 p.m. So there is a change there. Okay, so you're going to choose a poorly designed website and you're going to watch a user, or sometimes I'll refer to the user as a participant. You'll watch them run through a list of common tasks on that website. So users can include one of your friends, a colleague, or family members. So for instance, if you're running a usability test on a restaurant's poorly designed website, some common tasks might include finding the menu, locating prices, finding hours of operation, and looking for a phone number and address on the website. As the user attempts to accomplish these tasks, you're going to record data from them in a couple of ways. First, you're going to use the Think Aloud protocol, which is a common method from psychology in which you encourage your user to literally think aloud. You're going to ask them to talk about what they're doing, why they are clicking on what they're clicking on, what they are getting frustrated with, where they're getting where they're finding challenges, how they're anticipating on overcoming those challenges, etc. So you're going to use some kind of voice recorder, whether that be your phone or a computer or some kind of other electronic device, in order to collect quotes. Because user quotes are essential to showing your client that your concerns about their bad websites are very real, this type of recording your research is incredibly important. Ideally, you would also record the screen using a program like QuickTime Screen Recorder. But if you don't have access to that program or a similar type of program, then at the very least, you need to record the audio of the usability test. So I'm going to go over some simple common errors that you might come across. One note on choosing a poorly designed website before we move on, however, is that you don't want to do a huge website like Amazon or eBay. The simpler the website, the easier this assignment will be. The complexity of the OU engineering website is about as big as you want to go. Good websites in the past have included department websites from OU, restaurants and bars, apartment rental sites, and local businesses like U-Haul, the Norman Library, the water company. So as you are brainstorming and choosing a website, remember, an ugly website is not necessarily a difficult to use website. We're looking for websites in which users have a hard time accomplishing the tasks they need. So the big takeaway here, the big takeaways here are keep websites local and don't equate ugly for difficult to navigate. A lot of people think that what makes a bad website is ugliness, but much more than aesthetics, what really makes a bad website is that it's not user-centered. And in a follow-up lecture video, I will go over user-centered design. Bad websites don't let us accomplish what we want to. So in this unit, we're focusing specifically on tasks. And the big question that you want to keep in mind is, does this website let me accomplish the key task that I want? Or does this website let the user accomplish what they need to accomplish? The most simple rule in usable web design is don't make me think. This means a couple of things, but primarily it means everything from links to images should be self-explanatory. I should not have to puzzle for a long period of time where to find some information, or I shouldn't have to dig through information for an extended period of time to be able to locate what I need to locate. The first thing you'll be asking your users to evaluate is their general impression of the site's homepage. Homepages should be incredibly clear and thematic. Good homepages should have clear navigation, clear imagery and logo, a search bar. They should avoid needless words, and they should resonate with the target audience. But always keep the user in mind when you're thinking about these criteria. So when I say avoids needless words, it all depends on the targeted user, right? So if I'm looking at a website that is intended for bibliophiles, for example, then in that circumstance, I might find a website that's loaded with words because this website is targeting groups of people that love books and love to read. So it wouldn't be unusual if that website wasn't filled with words, but because the designer kept the target audience in mind. So again, it should resonate with the target audience. Another key part of a website's design is general site structure. This is how pages are linked to one another. I should be able to reach any internal page I want from the home page in 3 clicks or under. So that's a general rule, a good rule of thumb. In 3 clicks or under, the user should be able to locate whatever it is they're trying to locate. I should be able to predict what content will be in what section of the website under what links. So links should be clear, the language should be clear, the links should be readily located. Often in usability testing, to redesign a website structure, we use a method called card sorting. In card sorting, the web designer provides the subject with a list of topics and asks the user to categorize and group those topics together in whatever way feels right to them. So the next step down from a larger website architecture is individual page design. Good web pages have a clear visual hierarchy. So hey, look at that. There's a reason why we learned about visual hierarchy earlier in this course, after all. Keep in mind the design techniques that we covered before, such as visual hierarchy, scannability, easy font sizes and font styles to look through, and those are all details that you want to keep in mind for this unit as well. One of the most basic elements that leads to good or bad websites is following website genre standards. That is, if I asked you where a logo on most standard websites goes, you wouldn't say the lower right-hand corner, right? You wouldn't think that the logo would go here. Users expect that the logo would be in the upper left-hand corner, so up here. If I asked you where the main navigation bar goes, you'd say the top center, somewhere in this area, right? So users, as this diagram illustrates, expect things to be in specific places. So if you discover a website where the page design does not follow the genre, you might ask questions like, does that work? Does it work for the target audience? Do the design techniques that the designer put out there, is that something that makes the website work? Does it not work? Does it work only for a target audience? So these are ideas that we want to keep in mind. Okay, so in the video that follows, the second part of this lecture, I'm going to navigate through specific websites, and we're going to look at the different design features of them. So look out for that video and watch that one next.